Chapter 8. The man's name was Burn Sanderson. He was a young man who rode a good horse and was mighty nice and polite about taking his hat off to Mama when he dismounted in front of our cabin. He told Mama who he was. He said he was a newcomer to Salt Licks. He said that he'd come from down San Antonio way with a little bunch of cattle that he was grazing over in the Devil's River country. He said he couldn't afford to hire riders, so he'd brought along a couple of dogs to help him herd his cattle. One of these dogs, the best one, had disappeared. He'd inquired around Salt Licks about it, and Bud Searcy had told him that we had the dog. A big yeller dog? Mama asked, looking sober and worried. Yes'm, the man said, then added with a grin, the worst egg sucker and camp robber you ever laid eyes on. Still you blind, that old devil will, but there was never a better cow dog born. Mama turned to me. Son, call old yeller, she said. I stood frozen in my tracks. I was so full of panic I couldn't move or think. Go on, son, Mama urged. I think he and little Arliss might be playing down by the creek somewhere. Mama, I gasped. We can't do without old Yeller. He's Travis. Mama's voice was too sharp. I knew I was whipped. I turned and went toward the creek, so mad at Bud Searcy that I couldn't see straight. Why couldn't he keep his blabbermouth shut? Come on up to the house, I told little Arliss. Just the way I said it let him know that something real bad was happening. He didn't argue or stick out his tongue or anything. He just got out of the water and followed me back to the house and embarrassed Mama and the young man nearly to death because he came packing his clothes in one hand instead of wearing them. I guess Burns Sanderson had gotten the idea of how much we thought of Old Yeller. Maybe Mama had told him some things about the dog while I was gone to the creek. Anyhow, he acted uncomfortable about taking the dog off. Now, Mrs. Coates, he said to Mama, your man is gone. You and the boys don't have much protection here. Bad as I need that old dog, I can make out without him until your man comes. But Mama shook her head. No, Mr. Sanderson, she said. He's your dog. The longer we keep him, the harder it'll be for us to give him up. Take him along. I can make my boys understand. The man tied his rope around Old Yeller's neck and mounted his horse. That's when little Arliss caught on to what was happening, and he threw a wall-eyed fit. He screamed and he hollered. He grabbed up a bunch of rocks and went to throwing them at Burn Sanderson. One hit Sanderson's horse in the flank. The horse bogged his head and went to pitching and bawling and grunting, and this excited Old Yeller. He chased after the horse, baying him at the top of his voice. And what with Mama running after little Arliss, hollering for him to shut up and quit throwing those rocks, it was altogether the biggest and loudest commotion that had taken place around our cabin for a good long while. When Burn Sanderson finished riding the pitch out of his scared horse, he hollered at Old Yeller, told him he'd better hush up that racket before he got his brains beat out. Then he rode back toward us, wearing a wide grin. His grin got wider as he saw how Mama and I were holding little Arliss. We each had him by one wrist and were holding him clear off the ground. He couldn't get any more rocks to throw that way, but it sure didn't keep him from dancing up and down in the air and screaming. Turn him loose, Sanderson said with a big laugh. He's not going to throw any more rocks at me. He swung down from his saddle. He came and got little Arliss and loved him up till he hushed screaming. He said, look, boy, do you really want that thieving old dog? He held little Arliss off and stared him straight in the eyes, waiting for Arliss to answer. Little Arliss stared straight back at him and didn't say a word. Well, do you? He insisted. Finally, little Arliss nodded, then tucked his chin and looked away. All right, Burn Sanderson said. We'll make a trade, just between you and me. I'll let you keep the old rascal, but you got to do something for me. He waited till little Arliss finally got up the nerve to ask what, then went on. Let's like this. I've hung around over there in that cow camp, eating my own cooking till I'm so starved out, I don't hardly throw a shadow. Now, if you could talk your mama into feeding me a real jam-up meal of woman-cooked grub, I think it would be worth at least a one-eared yeller dog, don't you? I didn't wait to hear any more. I ran off. I was so full of relief I was about to pop. I knew if I didn't get out of sight in a hurry, this Burn Sanderson was going to catch me crying. Mama cooked the best dinner that day that I ever ate. We had roast venison and fried catfish and stewed squirrel and black-eyed peas and cornbread and flour gravy and butter and wild honey and hog plum jelly and fresh buttermilk. I ate till it seemed my eyeballs would pop out of my head, and it didn't make anything like the showing that Burn Sanderson still made. He was a slim man, not nearly as big as Papa, and I never could figure out where he was putting all that grub. But long before he finally sighed and shook his head at the last of the squirrel stew, I was certain of one thing. He sure wouldn't have any trouble throwing a shadow on the ground for the rest of that day. A good black shadow. After dinner, he sat around for a while talking to me and Mama and making little Arliss some toy horses out of dried corn stalks. Then he said his thank yous to Mama and told me to come with him. I followed with him while he led his horse down to the spring for water. I remembered how Papa had led me away from the house like this the day he left and knew that Burn Sanderson had something he wanted to talk to me about. At the spring, he slipped the bits out of his horse's mouth to let him drink and turned to me. Now, boy, he said, I didn't want to tell your mama this. I don't want to worry her. There's a plague of hydrophobia making the rounds, and I want you to be on the lookout for it. I felt a scare run through me. I didn't know much about hydrophobia, but after what Bud Searcy had told us about his uncle that died, chained to a tree, I knew it was something bad. I stared at Bern Sanderson and didn't say anything. There's no mistake about it, he said. I've done shot two wolves, a fox, and a skunk that had it. Over at Salt Licks, a woman had to kill a bunch of house cats that her young'uns had been playing with. She wasn't sure, but she couldn't afford to take any chances. You can't either. But how will I know what to shoot and what not to? I wanted to know. Well, you can't hardly tell at first, he said. Not till they've already gone to foaming at the mouth and are reeling with blind staggers. Any time you see a critter acting that way, you know for sure. You watch for others that aren't that far along. You take a pet cat. If he takes to spitting and fighting at you for no reason, shoot him. Same with a dog. He'll get mad at nothing and want to bite you. Take a fox or a wildcat. You know they'll run from you, but when they don't run, they try to make at you, try to fight you. Shoot them. Shoot anything that acts unnatural. Don't fool around about it. It's too late after they've already bitten or scratched you. Talk like that made my heart jump up in my throat till I could hardly get my breath. I looked down at the ground and went to kicking around some rocks. You're not scared, are you, boy? I'm only telling you because I know your papa left you in charge of things. I know you can handle whatever comes up. I'm just telling you to watch close and not let anything, anything, get to you or your folks with hydrophobia. Think you can do it? I swallowed. I can do it, I told him. I'm not scared. The sternness left Bern Sanderson's face. He put a hand on my shoulder just as Papa had the day he left. Good boy, he said. That's the way a man talks. Then he gripped my shoulder real tight, mounted his horse, and rode off through the brush. I was so scared and mixed up about the danger of hydrophobia that it was clear into the next day before I even thought about thanking him for giving us Old Yeller.